And then I'll bring this up. Maybe. There it goes. So I'm not a big fan of PowerPoint. I think that some people like give you like death by PowerPoint. If you use the textbook publishers' PowerPoints, they always have like 75 slides for a chapter. And so you end up just trying to like push through. Mine will be more like 6 to 10 slides for a chapter. Okay. So I think it's meant to give you the main point, but then we'll have some, hopefully some conversation, not just me talking at you, but we'll see how that goes. I'm learning that this is a generation that mostly wants to be left alone to work on stuff so that lecture time becomes like a, how do we just survive through this so we can then work on the stuff? So hopefully we can have conversations and that'll be more valuable. There's Shanique. All right. So this is straight out of the book, okay? The learning objectives. All learning objectives mean, if case you probably noticed them in every textbook you've ever used, but all a learning objective means is this is the things that the author thinks you should learn during this chapter, okay? So when we go through and develop our course competencies, we try to find a book whose learning objectives are similar to our course competencies, right? So we can say, if this is what we want students to gain from this course, and that's why I don't use all 30 chapters of this book for this course, because some of those chapters don't meet our needs. Thank goodness, right? We'll stick to the 16 or so chapters that do suit our needs. So I don't want to read those to you. You can read them, but this is what they want you to be able to cover. If I were studying this for the first time, if I were a student, I would look at that first. Then probably what I would look at next is at the end of the way this book is structured, at the end of each section, there's like a key takeaways, which is really awesome, actually, right? Because you can kind of look at that. And you know, here's the hope. How many of you were involved in Boy Scouting when you were a kid? Okay, so several of you. So Boy Scouting is all about introducing young people, young men and women now, to concepts and making them try at least 21 different concepts, right? If you do a merit badge, you have to try something and actually have to be at least a little tiny bit proficient in it. My kids just did the welding merit badge last year, and they had to actually, you know, learn about welds, learn about safety of welding, learn about how the arc does what it does, and then they had to actually make something, and they made these little barbecue grills, which were actually pretty cool. But what I found with each of my kids as they've come up through scouting is by being introduced to these 21 different things, some that are required, some that are their choice, they find one or two or three things that they actually enjoyed and wanted to actually explore more. One of my kids took up welding, and he loves welding. He's a nuclear technician on a submarine, and he's trying to get his qualification to do nuclear welding, which means when a reactor has problems, somebody has to fix it. But all because he learned about that in scouting. So this is how I take college too. There are required courses and elective courses. You're going to take courses that you do not want to take, but you have to. This is probably one of them, okay? Some of you will leave this going, that was a complete waste of my time. I hated it, but I survived it. Others will be like, maybe I'm interested in law. Like, maybe I want to look into this and do more of this. There'll be parts of this that you'll be like, that's boring to me. And other parts of it, you're like, that's actually kind of interesting to me. I know you're busy, but don't be afraid if something interests you to like explore it on your own. Read more about it. At least read the Wikipedia entry on it, right? That's a good first step. This happened to me my first year in college, my second year in college. I was at a university called Hawaii Pacific University. I was taking a class in statistics, of all things. I'm not a statistician. And they started teaching us about measures of central tendency and measures of dispersion. And I was learning about the idea of standard deviations. I don't know if you've ever learned about that. And I was so like enthralled with the idea, not the actual work behind it, but with the idea that we could take a group of data that we could then understand how far away from the mean things are on some standard scale. And like all the uses of that came to my mind that I went home and I like just devised my own research project and did it. And that stuck with me forever. It may not be that for you, but it might be something you pick up in a class. And that's what we're trying to do. This isn't rote memorization. All right. I know, I just like lectured you on the importance of knowledge and gaining knowledge. You ever meet people who are just like strangely uncurious? And you're like, aren't you curious about anything? My family, like it's weird because my older kids, we grew up like we would play the encyclopedia game. That's nerdy. Where somebody would get an encyclopedia on Sunday afternoon after church, and they would read like the entry, and people had to like guess what the word or like the word was. My kids love that. My younger kids are like completely not, they're not interested in that at all. It's the strangest thing to me because I've always been curious. All right. So the two main theories of law that we're going to talk about in this class, although there are other theories out there, are what's called positivism and natural law. Okay. There's other thoughts, all sorts of other theories of how law comes about. You remember the other day I tried to like give this example of, you know, us of, I think we had a cabbage thief among us named Madison. And I said that we were unhappy because she was taking cabbages out of Stephen's yard, right? And we had to decide, are we going to make a rule against this? If so, how do we enforce that rule? So the question is this: why were we unhappy about it? And where does the notion of our being unhappy about it come from? So under positive law, the idea is that law is the command of the sovereign. In other words, whether it be a king or a president, it means we recognize somebody as the authority, and when they make a command, then that's what makes law. It could be an individual, like a king, or it could be a group, like a legislative body. Right? If the legislature passes the law, it's the law. Why? Because the legislature said it is. So that means we recognize lawmakers' commands as legitimate and that the morality of the law is not important. Even if I disagree with it, if the king said it, it's the law. If Congress said you have to wear your seatbelt, if the Arizona State Legislature says you have to wear a seatbelt, doesn't matter if I don't like it, I have to listen to it. That's positivist theory. Natural law theory is, this says law based on universal moral order. Just so you know, most people who believe in natural law believe in God. Okay, there are atheists who believe in it, and then they say, no, this is just the universe wills certain things. So the idea that theft is wrong could come because the sovereign says, thou shalt not steal here on earth, or it could come because some sovereign above any earthly sovereign, whether it be God or whether it just be the laws of nature, dictates that stealing is wrong. Does that make sense? And if you're a natural law person, you say there is some sort of universal order, whether it be God, whether it be the universe, and that's what decides what's right or wrong. And if the sovereign, whether it be the legislature or the king, makes a law, and that law goes against the universal moral order, I'm not bound by it. You could lock me away, you could torture me, but I will not obey that unjust law. So sometimes these two things can work together okay until the sovereign or until the legislature creates a law that some people